preparation for the gala event to take place in Tampa to promote scholarships to the Florida Inter-American Scholarship Foundation. May our efforts truly be those of efforts that are mindful of the heart as well as the mind. We ask now that you bless this food, those hands that you prepare, that we might share together in truth and grace. In thy holy name we pray. Thank you.
don't have any.
Thank you.
Hi, Borges. baby diamond.
Thank you.
Yeah. Once again, good afternoon. My name is Max Borges. I'll be your master of ceremonies, among other things. After we finish, I may have to clean all the plates to make sure that we make enough money for the foundation. As you're all probably aware, the Florida Inter-American Scholarship Foundation, it's a baby that was created back in 1981, thanks to the magnificent help of Senator Bob Graham, who visited Panama, and there he learned that the Soviet Union was giving a tremendous amount of scholarships to Panamanian students, and the United States was giving very few. In fact, we have a very nice brochure that has been published by the foundation. That it says that the Soviets gained over 10,000 scholarships last year, and the United States only gave 667. So the course of the foundation is very clear. We just like to let the people in Central and South America and the Caribbean Basin what democracy is, so they be able to compare the difference between our system and the system of the Soviets. Last year, some of those of you who attended our luncheon, and by the way, this is our second annual luncheon, might recall that my remarks were very serious, and I was told by Jeff Sharkey that I was very dramatic. Subsequently, I learned a nice joke, and I figured that I want to start today with it. And it goes something like this. There was a Cuban fellow who died in Havana, and rather than going to heaven, he went to hell. And when he arrived there, he was attended at the door by Satan. And Satan told him that there were two kinds of hell, a democratic hell and a communist hell. Which one he would like to choose? And the Cuban fellow comes in from Cuba, and all the problems he had there, he said, no, I won't. Want to know anything about communism, I would like to go to the democratic hell. And so he was taking it. When he arrived there, he was told, well, here, the first thing we do is we give you a brand new Cadillac, or you can choose a brand new Lincoln. We will give you this beautiful house that you see up there in the mountain, and we will give you credit cards and all the money. And at the end of 6 months, we will take you, and we will lay you over that piece of plywood that you see there spiked with nails. And then we will take this big 10-ton roller and we will roll it right over you. So that part he didn't like. And he said, well, I like everything else, but the ending is kind of dramatic. Could you show me what the communistic hell looks like? He said, sure, come over here. So he takes him over there. He said, well, here, first of all, we don't have any houses, but we will give you some lumber and you can build your own house here. We don't have automobiles, but you see that old bicycle there? You can have it so you can ride around. And there's no money, but you can talk to people and exchange for food and all of that. And at the end of 6 months, we will take that big 10-ton roller that you see there, we will put you over that piece of plywood spiked with nails, and we will roll it right over you. So the Cuban guy says, well, but how come there are so many people in here? And in the Democratic Hill, there was almost nobody. At least for 6 months, and the other one you lived like a king. He says, well, Satan says, why don't you talk to some of the people here? So he went over and says, hey, you, why did you come here? At least for 6 months, and the other one you look like a king. He says, yeah, but you see, I've been here for 5 years. Because when they have the nails, they don't have the plywood. When they have the plywood, the roller coaster works. It is my distinct pleasure to bring to you a person that has undoubtedly made our city a very international city, a person that is truly making that Tampa will be as well as some other city that claims to be the capital of Latin America, will make this one here the capital of Latin America. Ladies and gentlemen, Mayor Sandy Freeman.
Delighted to be here and welcome you on behalf of the city of Tampa. This is certainly a worthwhile endeavor on the part of the Florida Inter-American Scholarship Foundation. I am a parent, as many of you know, and even apart from that, I don't think that there is anything more important to our country and certainly to the future of our country and the future of the world than education. And democracy has to be learned, and what a superb way in which to educate people of South America, Central America, and the Caribbean Basin toward democracy and through this scholarship program. I was appalled at the numbers that Max cited and had told me previously of the Soviets and the scholarships given to students to learn their system. To understand the system, and the paltry number of scholarships that we in America give so that people can learn about us. And if our world is to be a safe one and a democratic one, a more democratic one, and if we are to protect the institutions that already exist and hopefully enlighten others to move toward more democratic institutions throughout the world, and most especially through our neighbors to the south, then education, to me, is the primary way and the primary tool at our disposal. I hope that all of you, and I will certainly attempt to do my part, to educate the people of this area to the advantages of contributing to this foundation so that our world will be a little safer, that our hands will be extended to our fellow man, and that my children and your children will be able to live in a safer, peaceful, and much more democratic world than we live in today. I salute you for your efforts. I know that you will be successful, and I pledge to help you in any way that I can and through my offices toward that end.
Thank you, Mayor Freeman. The next person that I'd like to introduce is the gentleman who is in charge of going throughout the state, working very hard to make this foundation a very successful foundation. I can tell you very honestly that one of the most difficult persons that find in his office is the gentleman that I'm about to introduce. I can get the governor of the state, or I can even get President Reagan faster than I can get Mr. Jeff Sharkey. Ladies and gentlemen, Jeff Sharkey.
Good afternoon. I'm leaving my phone number up here in case anybody wants to reach me. But thank you for the introduction. My name is Jeff Sharkey, and I just wanted to comment on Max's joke as well. Being a bureaucrat from Tallahassee, I don't want to make the reference that we're either in heaven or hell, or democratic or communistic, but it's come to my understanding lately that we have the plywood in Tallahassee. We have the hammers, but we probably don't have the tacks. That's my joke for the day. So we have a little problem moving ahead as well. But it's a pleasure to be here today and talk to be at the second annual luncheon for the Florida Inter-American Scholarship Foundation. I am honored to be the executive director of that organization. I am the director of the Office of International Education for the state of Florida under Commissioner Betty Castor, and this represents a public-private partnership. The state providing appropriation, $280,000 last year, private sector raising money to match those funds and stretch our resources to provide scholarships for students from throughout 12 countries to come and study in Florida's community colleges and universities, and then to return home to apply those skills. It's people like you sitting here in the audience that really make that program worthwhile. I just wanted to mention I came from a small little fundraiser we had in Miami last weekend with Jimmy Buffett, who was one of our trustees of this foundation, put on a big Caribbean music festival, and a contingent of Tampa people came down to this concert, 10,000 screaming bodies out at Marine Stadium, and Carmen Bolt and Jill Fagaldi turned to me and said, you know, if you could give us some competition in Tampa, it'd be helpful. But we're anticipating a much bigger turnout in April for our fundraiser, and so we're real excited about that. I want to just talk very briefly, introduce a couple of people, and then bring in our guest speaker for the day. Just remarking on those scholarship statistics, and I will leave that all alone, and I'll be happy to tell you more about the program. But if you took the number of people in this room and tripled it, every week that many people are providing scholarship opportunities to study in Eastern Bloc countries. Let's take this same group and just take this table. Just take this table. That many people are provided opportunities by the entire United States government to study in the United States throughout all of Central America, the Caribbean Basin, Latin America. Those figures are improving. To some extent, Florida's little program has stimulated the federal government, I'm happy to say, to really respond. Senator Graham has now got a piece of legislation that would take this public-private partnership program and expand it throughout the United States to get people like such as yourselves involved. And so we're very excited about it. Last year, the Tampa committee here and the community and people in the audience put on a very exciting activity at Tall Ships in Tampa Bay, bringing in tall ships for sale at sunset with our business leaders, political leaders in the state, celebrities sailing on the bay. I'm going to put in a plug for April 9th, Armada for the Americas, with the flotilla of boats spearheaded by Major Clipper Ship. Sailing out of the bay again, lots of fun. We're going to get some celebrities from all of the state, outside of the state, throughout the region to come up and participate in that. So I wanted to plug that. Very quickly, we've got some of the students here from the program that I wanted to introduce, and a special guest, Commissioner Betty Castor, who's really taking the leadership on this program at the state level, sent one of her emissaries down, Mr. Stan Komet, who is in charge of business partnerships for the state. This is one of our prominent business partnerships around. So Stan, I don't know if you want to stand. You get a chance to talk to him right around. We're going to utilize him and put him out to one of the bows of one of the big boats to attract additional resources. But I wanted to introduce three of our students here and have them come up real quickly and just introduce themselves. A gentleman over in the corner, I dragged him away from the library. They're studying for their finals. We have Mr. Leslie Seville from Haiti, Michael Liu from Jamaica, Tommy Riley from Panama. They're starting to dress better than me. That concerns me tremendously.
I'm Leslie Seville, and I'm from Haiti. I've been here for about 3 years, and I'm studying natural engineering at USF. Actually, Jeff really caught me by surprise because I didn't know how I was going to come and say something. So I wasn't prepared for that. I was quite prepared to tell you about my final. But anyway, I'm very glad I came. Even though I had to take a test earlier and I can spare it for me because I won't have to worry about it anymore when I go back. And I thank God for being here. And you really showed me that you care about us. Thank you very much.
I'm Michael Liu from Jamaica. And my being here is made possible by people like you who are making a contribution to get a chance to study in a field that I'm really interested in, and to get a degree that will benefit for me and my country. I want to say thank you very much, and your being here is proof to me that you care about other people like me who may not have the opportunity to study in a college, but you being here make it possible for others to come here and study and to get in the position in life whereby they can benefit themselves. And second, I want to say thanks and to borrow a quote from somebody else. Mine is a terrible thing to waste. Thank you.
My name is Jaime Riley. I'm from Panama. I'm studying computer engineering at USF. Like they said, we are being here is made possible by people like you, and I could never thank you enough, I guess, because if it weren't for people like you, I wouldn't be here at all. I mean, I never had a chance, and my parents didn't have the means, and so thank you again, and please contribute to this forum.
I need desserts for about 10 minutes here, so. Those are the quality of the kinds of students that this program supports. Presently, there are 24 students around the state of Florida in a long-term training program, graduate degree, or undergraduate degree program. We have 15 short-term students, additionally, who are sponsored with the same public-private partnership PAC that you were part of. Let me move ahead and introduce to you Max, if I may indulge, would you like to allow me to do this? Because I had a rare opportunity to chat with this gentleman earlier today, picking him up from the plane. Our guest speaker today was very kind enough to come up to Tampa to address this luncheon. He is a very provocative, interesting individual who can paint a picture of the dynamic of Central America, in particular Panama, that I think we will find very interesting. The picture that really begins to target and focus in on the importance of democratic institutions in all of our lives. And it's in your program, you have a bio on Dr. Roberto Eisenman, Jr., so I'm not going to belabor that, but it is really of interest to me to be able to speak, exchange ideas, and to listen to someone with this kind of intellect and someone with this kind of vision. So I will let him speak for himself. Would you please give a round of applause for Dr. Roberto Eisenman?
Thank you very much for allowing me to be with you this afternoon, and also for giving me a free doctorate, which I don't merit. In my part of the world, this is siesta time, so I will try and be very short on my comments and allow for questions and answers that will probably be the most interesting part of the afternoon. I'd like to talk a little bit about a conflict of visions. Jeff talked about visions, and I think that it's an important way to analyze our problem. The difference between the United States and the Soviet Union, or the differences between the United States and the Soviet Union, are mostly defined as a conflict between contending interests. I prefer to believe and to express the differences as a conflict of visions. What's the difference between one and the other, we might ask ourselves. And Thomas Sowell said it very well when he said, the conflicts of interest dominate the short term. Conflicts of visions dominate history. Interests confront the urgent, practical issues, many times with an urgency that sacrifices our basic values. Such is the case of Panama, my country, where the U.S. has for 20 years supported a corrupt, military kleptocracy. This is not the word to describe it. In the interest of the short-term stability that these military regimes pretend to want. And the U.S. has done this, sacrificing the most precious values for which it stands, which is democracy. But this group, obviously, is a group dedicated to visions, as the education which you are offering our less privileged citizens takes the long view. The vision of offering opportunity and teaching the basic values of your privileged nation. Democracy is, after all, the most revolutionary of political systems. You, the United States, must not continue to be a status quo power, permitting the Soviet Union, which is the most petrified and reactionary of political systems, to portray itself as the world's revolutionary. I know that some will say that I'm being idealistic, that we must dispense with visions and deal only with realities. To these we must say that dealing only with reality may be the most utopian vision of all. Visions are like maps that keep us on course with our values. If we accept using maps to drive our cars, why should we not accept using maps to drive our nation? Visions are so often simplistic, or so simplistic, that we tend to forget they exist. A basic assumption that participatory democracy requires education is a vision so simplistic that it's many times forgotten. In my country, until 1984, and this has been said today, socialist countries were offering scholarships to approximately 700 needy Panamanian citizens per year. And we had anywhere from 7,000 to 10,000 young men and women of our country educated in socialist countries. At that point in time, how many scholarships was the U.S. giving our citizens? Zero. Zero. At a time when our understanding is that education in the U.S. was in crisis. Many of the top-level universities continue to have extreme amounts of people wanting to go to them. Many of the universities in the middle sections of the United States were having problems getting enough students. So obviously it's a natural to think that the U.S. could finance scholarships to people in our countries and at the same time support its own educational system. So it was a natural. Fortunately, today we are experimenting change thanks to groups such as yours. Today, with vision, people like yourselves and AID, the US government, have a program that in Panama is working through a private foundation called COSPIRE, which is now working with $5 million giving scholarships, and I understand what you all have done in Panama is a great part of that effort. And we now have between 300 and 350 Panamanian students studying in the United States. This is a vision dedicated to get back on course. But it's only a startup. And there's a lot of catching up to do. A lot of catching up. We must remember that all of these students that come back from socialist countries, and let's assume, because anybody who has been in the Soviet Union and visited Patrice Lumumba University and talked to the students from Latin America there, would find that they have to go through a 6-month course in language just to start off understanding their courses. And obviously the weather is quite hostile to their traditions. And they can't go back home for Christmas vacations, so they spend 4 years in this environment. So let's assume that just half of them come back convinced. They can't get jobs in the private sector. We don't employ people from Patrice Lumumba University. They're all going to government. It's the only place for employment. So just take these numbers and play with them. In a country of 2 million inhabitants, where there might be 150,000 government employees, if you have 8 or 10,000 educated in the Soviet Union or East Bloc countries, you can see what it can do to your government bureaucracy. So I also salute you and thank you for what you're doing. I think listening to these young men needs no further explanation. They have the opportunity, thanks to what you are doing. Let's get back a bit to Panama and the political aspect of the 20 years of U.S. support to the Panama military regime. This support alienating the U.S. from the Panamanian people, from people such as myself. And if you look at me, you can obviously come to the conclusion that I'm not anti-American by any means. There has recently been indications of a distancing of the U.S. administration from the Noriega regime, because the Panamanian people have come together in what I consider is probably Latin America's first non-violent protest movement to overthrow a military regime. And I think this is important not only for Panamanians, but for all of us. Because if we win, and I'm sure we will, it will change the face of politics in Latin America for a good many years to come. Our tradition is that we shoot at each other. And then we go from rightist dictatorships to leftist dictatorships, back to rightist dictatorships, and the pendulum goes from one extreme to the other, and we never get a chance to build on our democratic values. And believe me, we have democratic values. We believe in democratic values. We want participatory democracy. We don't want heavy-handed military governments. So Panama is now developing this unique political phenomenon. For the first time, we have decided that we are going to make it through non-violent means. No matter how much violence that regime gives back to us in our protest movement. We have been going now for 5 months, 5 long months. And there are 4 particularities that I'd like to mention on our movement. The first is that it was a spontaneous reaction. When the second man in the Defense Force was cashiered and he confessed, to use a word, all the political crimes, said nothing new, nothing the Panamanians didn't know, but the confession of a participant was the last straw. The population just spontaneously erupted. And there are some very interesting ingredients. Number one, the flag of the movement is white. Why white? Because the genius of the people wanted to show a non-partisan movement. This is no longer the political partisan opposition versus a military regime. This is the people versus one man and his system. The system of protest is nonviolent. It's what we call in Spanish las pes. It's pito, paila, pañuelo, papel, por Panama. Sounds ridiculous, but that's the way it is. Pito is horn. People make a lot of noise. Paila is, how would you say that in English? Pots and pans. They beat on pots and pans. Pañuelo, the white handkerchiefs. Papel, they throw white paper out of the buildings like the ticker tape parades of New York. Por Panama, por Panama. And these are the arms of the people. But every little white handkerchief has the strength of a bazooka when there are thousands and thousands of them shown. And what has been the reaction of our military? Every possible oppressive tactic in the little black book. Mass arrests, mass beatings, torture in the jails, the most horrible of tortures. As soon as you get arrested in Panama, you are threatened with sexual abuse. This is an obsession of the Noriega regime, sexual abuse. And people, men and women, have been sexually abused in the jails by people infected with AIDS. Now, this is the most horrible of tortures that I have ever heard. But the people continue, and our vision is one of legitimate democracy. And we need your solidarity. We need for you to push your government towards that vision and those values that you represent and stand for. Today, while our protest movement is still in the hands of the moderates, and we are nonviolent, we are in a no-lose situation. Nothing can be worse than what we have, and the options are all good. But tomorrow, if the shooting starts, the moderates lose control. Control goes to the extreme forces on both sides, and we enter another no-win situation, such as we have now in Central America, and that we all know. So, I'll stop there. I have a 4-minute tape, which I'd like you to listen to, because it'll give you a more real sense of what I've been talking about. You will see a lot of government violence, you will see a lot of goon squads shooting at people, and you will see what the protest movement is all about. And after that, we can open it to questions and answers.
Just start to play.
say that the major crisis will occur within the next 6 months. I think that his support within the country is absolutely nil now, except for those 20,000 rifles. I think his international support is withering, and
Panama and repack this Panama lobster and ship to the United States.
That's it. It's happening every day. So this is the basis of the relationship with Cuba. Now with Nicaragua, same thing happens. Besides, of course, there is a lot of gun running. The Colombian army knows perfectly well that Panama is used to arm the M-19, and that the M-19 has base operations in Panama, not military operations, but their commercial enterprises based in Panama, and banked through Panama. So Panama is sort of a free area for them to operate in, and that is the basis of the relationship, and it's a very close one. Having a problem with the United States, he will bring in Daniel Ortega to help him create havoc or throw out the AID as he did yesterday from Panama and things such as those. But there's really no ideology to the man. It's power for power's sake and for corruption's sake. There's no project at all. So the country is actually dead in the water. I don't know if that answers your question.
What do you and your friends in the nonviolent Democratic opposition say to those ultra-conservative Americans who have persuaded themselves that unless they back the military dictator, they run the risk of the canal perhaps falling into hands which would be unfriendly to the U.S.?
We're going to have to interrupt the meeting. We have been advised that there is no immediate danger, but there seems to be a fire in the building. I want to say thank you to the best building company in town, Raymar Construction, who feeds all these people, Cash and Carry, who has been very nice to sponsor tonight. And all the trustees, I'm sorry we can't mention them right now. It has been a very hot meeting. Thank you.